So welcome back to the Impact Arena here in Thailand, just north of Bangkok. What a privilege to be here. Three world-class tournaments back-to-back. And it's semi-finals day here at the Toyota Thailand Open. Six semi-finals completed. Next up is the first of our men's singles. And it's an all-Danish affair. It's the man promoted from the reserve list, Hans-Kristian Vittinghus, up against the World Championship silver medalist, Anders Antonsen. So as far as the men's singles draw is concerned, by quarterfinal stage, we only had three seeds. We had started with seven, but we were down to three seeds and only one in the top half of the draw. And that, as you can see, was Anders Antonsen. Three Danes at quarterfinal stage, two players from Chinese Taipei. They played against each other in the bottom section there. And by a semi-final stage, still three seeds, still only one in the top half, but three Danes. And when you consider last week, our four semi-finalists were from four different nations. What's happened to Denmark this week? They've been eating their cornflakes for breakfast or something, haven't they?
They've done well. They have done well. Or fried rice, whatever it is.
Yeah, more likely.
Yes.
So here comes the man who got on an aeroplane from Copenhagen, not knowing if he'd even participate in these tournaments. He was on the reserve list. He thought, I might as well go. I may as well take the chance. And here he is on semi-finals day. His opponent, this man, Anders Antonsen, didn't have the best of weeks last week, lost in the very first round to Liu Daren in two straight games. But it's good to see Antonsen here too, because on the 5th of December he was diagnosed with having COVID, so he had to self-isolate, miss some of his training. So great to have both these Danes here in this all-Danish semi-final. So this, I was very surprised, was the first international meeting between these two players. I'm sure they played each other in club competition or national competition back in Denmark. But first in international competition. Vittinghus, well, replaced Koki Watanabe in the men's singles draw this week and all the way through to the semi-final. Hasn't actually played against another or a seed to get through, because Anthony Ginting, the number five seed, lost in the second round to Lee Chek Yu. And of course, this is the top section of the draw, so we lost the number one seed, the reigning world champion, Kento Momota, before the tournament got underway. Well, Vittinghus turned 35 last Saturday, so exactly 7 days ago. He's number 42 on the world ranking, but has been as high as eight, a total of 11 weeks at number eight in the world. Well, this is his first semi-final for some considerable time, since he went on to win the Australian Super Series back in 2016. So this a major breakthrough after a number of very difficult months, really in the wilderness for Vittinghus. Well, there in the first round, he beat the man who was promoted from the reserve list to replace Momota, Penalva from Spain, then beat Rustavito in three games, dropped the opening game, as you can see. And then in the quarterfinal against Lee Chuk Ye of Hong Kong, also dropped the opening game and won a thriller 21-19 in the deciding game in an hour and 17 minutes. So to Anders Antonsen, who's only 23 years of age, born in Aarhus, and he went back up to his career high ranking just before the rankings were frozen. So a total of 7 weeks before the rankings weren't rerun anymore because of the global lockdown. Now, in his first match, he beat the 2016 winner, captain on Saksin Sumbunsak, the left-hander, and very comfortable it was too. Sadly, the 2013 winner, Kidambi Srikanth, had to withdraw because, having won his first match, his roommate, Sai Praneeth, tested positive for COVID, and therefore Kidambi himself having to self-isolate. A wonderful quarter-final. He had to save a match point at 19-20 down in the deciding game against Samir Verma, but eventually won it 22-20 in an hour and 21 minutes. So our court officials for this one, Emmanuel Habutsi of Botswana, and our service judge from Thailand. Morten, I don't know if you've been seeing any of the social media that's been going on prior to yesterday's quarterfinal match for Hans-Kristian Vittinghus, because he suddenly found thousands and thousands of Indonesian fans, because they knew that if he beat Lee Chek Yew from Hong Kong, then Ginting. Anthony Ginting was going to qualify for the World Tour Finals.
So suddenly
they were urging him on.
Am I right? Yeah. Hans-Kristian Solberg Vittinghus,
it happened.
Denmark.
It did. In a thrilling match.
Yeah, you're right.
And on my left, Anders Antonsen, Denmark. Hans-Kristian Solberg Vittinghus to serve. Lavor, play.
So the man promoted from the qualifying, Vittinghus, far side of the court, against the World Championship silver medalist, number three seed, Anders Antonsen. So the question mark in my mind, Morten, is what has Vittinghus got left? Last 2 days, he's played hard three-game matches. Last 2 days, Anders Antonsen won hard match, but his first round match, very easy, 8-8, 31 minutes, yeah. And he didn't have to play a second round match.
Walk over in the second.
Yeah.
But we have to be honest and say that Anders Antonsen looked a little bit jaded yesterday when he was playing Samir Verma.
Yeah,
at
true.
Very various stages in the match. So I don't really know what Anders has got, and if it becomes a physical game, I'm not really sure who will be the strongest of these two at the moment, you know, taking everything into consideration of what you just said.
Interesting. Well, when Vittinghus celebrated his 35th birthday last Saturday, he posted on social media that he's now eligible for the veterans.
For the veterans, yes.
And here he is.
He would be a strong veteran for a few years to come.
He certainly would, but I hope he doesn't go into the veterans. I hope he still plays on the World Tour.
That's a good play by Anders.
Service over. 1-2.
I know we did not, you and I, commentate on Vittinghus yesterday, but we saw it from the corner of our eyes. And there was one thing I noticed, that Vittinghus normally celebrates his points quite loudly. But yesterday, there was hardly any celebration. And he was 2-love up here, and still no celebration.
Yeah, but it's only 2-love.
Still, I'm telling you. He's quite vocal.
Do you think it's because, obviously, we don't have any fans in, there's no crowd here, and quite frankly, at times you can hear a pin drop.
Yes.
And that it becomes more self-conscious. Not that it's affected Carolina Marin, who we saw a couple of matches ago. But I wonder if he's feeling more self-conscious because he's not feeding his celebration off the fans.
That could be a very, very good explanation. I haven't really thought of that. That's a good explanation.
Oh my goodness, what on earth was that, Anders Antonsen? He must have changed his mind. Surely.
The shot from Vittinghus was very tight. This one can't really lift it and try to disguise it as well as he can. But as we can all see, it did not work out.
Service over. 5, 4, 3. Service over for all.
You know these two players very well, obviously.
Yes.
Morten, tactically, how do you think this is going to pan out? The reason I ask you is because I think of Vittinghus very much as a runner on court, whereas I think Antonsen is quite happy to try and dictate the pace. And I see... I don't know whether I'm misreading this. I mean, that's why I asked the question. How do you see it panning out tactically?
I think if we take Anas first, he needs to stay as fresh as possible in order for him to be able to inject pace as when needed, if he wants to change pace. So it's important for him to stay as fresh as possible. And this is not helping his course, this long rally here. If you look at
five,
it from Vittinghus' point of view,
four.
This rally was really playing into his hands. He likes to play these long-drawn rallies and really sap the energy from his opponent. He's got a good smash, but he's not using it that much. The problem for Vittinghus is sometimes that he running into situations where he's playing mistake after mistake after mistake. So he's got to be very careful not having these run of mistakes.
Yeah. So
six,
if Anders wants to avoid
four.
The long, long rallies, then he really should be taking the initiative in the rally.
Yeah, and try to go into flat play as well. And he's got a good reach when it comes to flat play. I think he will win the flat play against Vittinghus.
It's going wide.
Service over. 5, 6.
When he put his hand up there to indicate that he wanted to towel down Antonsen, I thought for a split second, he's never challenging that, I thought.
No,
it wasn't a challenge. He was asking to tell down. I realise that now, but for a
just
moment.
Split second, yes.
Service over, 7-5. Yeah,
that seemed to be a bit of a missed hit smash
six.
From Vittinghus.
Yeah, he was totally out of balance. But I also think there's a little bit of psychology in this because, again, if you start celebrating your points a little bit too much against someone that you have your daily training with, it's also sending, you know, some signals. And I think both players are quite aware that, you know, they, after this match, also have to be very good friends and still have to work hard back home in training.
Yes, because the whole training of badminton, you need sparring partners. So if you completely alienate yourself from your training partners who you rely on to get good sparring,
yes,
because you've been over the top celebrating in a competitive match, then they're not going to help you in training.
Exactly. Oh,
that's a lovely shot.
Beautiful.
9-6.
Look where that's landed. Well in front of the front service line there. An indication of just what an acute angle it was.
Yeah, good quality.
Yeah.
Service over, 7-9.
Oh, that's a nice little moment. I think he was trying to blow it over. He didn't think it was going over. Let's have a look.
And he is so right.
It wasn't going over.
It was never coming over, that one.
But Vittinghus was not faulted.
Nope.
That's right. They were having a little smile at each other.
Yes. By Antonsen. Good anticipation.
It's
interesting that Antonsen is not using his smash at all. I don't know if you noticed that.
I haven't. Yeah.
7.
And I think that incident at the net we just saw before was a very, very fine example of what we mentioned about celebration and objecting, and you know, you don't want to be over the top when you have your sparring player to play with.
Yeah.
Had Antonsen played anyone else, I'm sure he would have objected to that one.
Mm. That's a great lift.
Perfect lift.
Yeah. Followed up with a perfect smash.
Service over. 8-10.
Yeah, now I like that. That was all about placement, wasn't it?
It was.
Nine.
Rather than power.
10.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good play from Vittinghus.
Let.
Hmm. He's already taking an age in between rallies, Antonsen. An awful lot of taking of time in yesterday's quarter final against Samir Verma. Overdone it.
Yeah.
So to the mid-game interval, and it's Anders Antonsen who has the advantage, a 2-point advantage against fellow Dane Hans-Kristian Vittinghus.
And what a luxury it is for Kenneth Jonassen to have 3 in the semi-final, but only one match to focus on.
Yeah.
Because as we know now, and we will see, the two players are having no coaching as they come from the same country and same training setup.
We'll be docking your wages as you don't have to do a translation.
Yeah, that would be the next. That would be the next.
But in all seriousness, for Vittinghus, you know, I was saying in the early stages, the last semi-final at this sort of level, I've counted as the Australian Super Series back in 2016. He was in the semi-final of the Malaysian Masters 500 event. In 2018. I don't know if you call that an equal to a Super Series. You probably do.
Yeah.
But it's been a while.
It's been a while.
Yeah. Is the point that
I think you said it so right when you say he's been out in the wilderness for a while, and yeah. I do agree with you on that. But it's nice to have him back and playing as well as what he's doing here in this tournament.
Yeah, nice angle from Antonsen. Yeah, Vittinghus is very popular on the tour, isn't he? He's very popular with the fans. Delightful man.
And he's very vocal as well. He's liking good discussions and interaction with the other players, coaches, fans, and all the rest of it.
Yeah. He was on the Players Council for a while, wasn't he, on the BWF?
He was.
Service over, 10-12.
I have to say, this isn't how I expected the match to go. I expected Anders Antonsen to come out all guns blazing and go on the attack and try and make the rallies short and sharp and really impose his dominance.
But maybe he knows that he can't do that. So he's holding back a bit and waiting more patiently.
Oh, that's great defence.
Yeah, but a poor kill
11,
or
12.
Attempt to kill from Antonsen, and that was a big one. We will see it here.
Yeah.
But I like some of the tactics from Antonsen, because he is trying to exploit the forehand at the front of the court on Vittinghus, trying to notice how many times shots are directed to that corner.
Just long.
Service over, 13-11.
Yes, good angle.
Service over, 12-13.
Compression bandage on Vittinghus's right arm. Compression stockings on the legs.
Yeah. Trying to look after himself, I think, at the age of 35. Chances of pulling small muscles and all that, of course, getting greater.
Yeah. Oh dear.
Service over.
Is that the first service 14, error of the match, Morten?
12.
I think so, yes.
Yeah.
I think Antonsen will try to inject pace now. Not because of the celebration, but the way he played this rally. Trying to play it faster, more urgency. I think he will try to pull away now.
Oh.
That is well worked by Vittinghus.
It is.
Service over. 13-15. Yes. Thank
you. Well, Antonsen doesn't look as fit and sharp to me as he did when he reached his two finals last year. First of all, in the Indonesian Masters, where he was the defending champion. And then, of course, he won the title at the Denmark 750 event. And I think this horrible virus that's gripped the world, I think it's had a bit of a lasting effect on Antonsen.
Yeah, for the time being, I think it's got an effect. You can see he's not completely 100% recovered.
Did you see that reaction 15. After the rally from Antonsen?
I saw that.
Yeah. Little sign of frustration. I don't know if we'll see it. He holds his racket, bends it out of frustration. Yes. Didn't like that. Ah, that's lovely. What a good shot.
But exploiting the forehand side 16, of the front of the court.
14. Service over, 15-16.
Well, as soon as you turn your back on the nets to play that backhand from deep in court, you can't see where your opponent is.
No, but I'm amazed that Vittinghus hasn't done it before, because all replies from Antonsen from every time he's turning around playing that backhand has been that shot. So I'm amazed it's first time he's there really attacking it. That's a good smash down the line from Antonsen.
Service over, 17-15.
Oh, yes.
Service over, 16-17.
I really, really feared before this match got underway, Morten, that Vittinghus would be too fatigued after his two long matches over the last 2 days. Because the thing is, when you get older, you don't recover as quickly.
Yeah, but I think he's done well.
So do I.
I think he's looking really sharp and fresh.
Service over, 18-16.
But maybe that was the first small sign of fatigue from Vittinghus. We will know in 5 minutes' time.
Gone wide. Oh, he's keeping in touch. Once again, there's just one point in it.
He's taking his time.
And the umpire's allowing it.
Yeah. Mamma mia.
Yeah.
Really taking his time.
Let.
And then says he's not ready. Now claiming that Vittinghus took too long. Great lift.
He's controlling. Lift. He's controlling the drift really, really well. Yeah. Vittinghus. I've been wanting to say that for a little while, and here we had another fine example of it.
Yeah, I think that landed plumb on the line, didn't it?
It did.
Let's have a look. Watch it, watch it. Yes, just inside the line.
Yeah, it's just on the inside of the line. That's
perfect.
Perfect.
Perfect. 18 all.
Yeah. Anyone's game.
That one's just long.
Service over. 19-18.
Take courage to leave that one from Antonsen, I think. When he misjudged the first one.
Challenge here.
Yeah.
And from Antonsen. Challenges called in.
First challenge of this men's singles. Oh yeah, now that was plumb on the line.
Yeah.
Oh, wasted challenge.
Challenge unsuccessful, one challenge remaining.
So 19 all.
Service over. 19 all.
We're having fun, aren't we?
Yeah.
It's close.
Late.
But it would be nice, I think, if the umpire would be able to speed it up a bit between the rallies. I think they have been allowed to take too much time.
Oh! Well, threw in the flick serve and it paid dividends because the error from Antonsen. And now it's game point opportunity.
But that's courageous play from Vittinghus because he's flicking with the with the drift. Perhaps anticipating that Anton would jump the surf. Another one there.
Oh! Opening game. To Hans-Kristian Vittinghus.
Hans-Kristian Solberg Vittinghus.
The man who was promoted from the reserve list. Would you believe it? Opening game. Puts this away with venom.
Yeah, he really went for that one.
21-19. Opening game in 26 minutes.
Is going through his mind.
Which one are we talking about?
Unless he looked very thoughtful. Sort of deep in thoughts, I think. Will he inject the pace now when he's playing with the drift?
I think he has to.
Twenty seconds.
So for a man who didn't know whether he was actually going to play a match when he left Copenhagen
on the 3rd of January,
3 weeks ago. Well, this is remarkable, isn't it? One game up in the semi-final
second
against
game.
Anders Antonsen.
Love all. Play.
Oh, that's sweet. Okay,
one
Morten, I've got
love.
A quiz question today with a difference. And okay. the difference is I don't know the answer.
Okay, that's a difference.
Okay. I ran out of research time this morning.
Okay.
I was trying to figure out the last time, if it's ever happened, that there's been three Danes in the men's singles semi-finals at an event of this level.
There has.
So, when?
1988.
So before the Super Series?
Yes.
Yeah. All England. Three Danes.
Three Danes. Yves Frederiksen, Jens-Peter Nyhoff.
And you.
And me.
Yeah. Yeah. But I was really thinking about since the inception of the Super Series
and the
World Tour. So if anybody out there knows, contact the BWF on any of their platforms and let us know.
Three, love.
Or maybe I should just get up earlier to do my research properly.
4 o'clock.
Only went to bed at 2.
Never mind. But I like you putting yourself on the spot. I think that's nice.
Yeah, nicely done. Well, this is very, very worrying
Four
times if
love.
You're an Anders Antonsen fan.
Yeah, it doesn't look good.
No.
It seems like there is no energy left to do anything.
And the other interesting thing is, it was Vittinghus who chose ends.
He did.
And I noticed in his quarterfinal yesterday, which was on court number 2, this near side of the court, as we look down, is where he finished the match. So it's where he played the second game, and it's where he played the second half of the third game.
Yes.
So he thinks he's now at the better end.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't disagree with that in singles, to be honest. That's
out.
Gone wide.
Yeah, it's out.
Five, love.
Dear me.
He's finding it very tough to find answers, I think. Running out of ideas, Antonsen.
Seven love.
Yeah,
I feel sorry for Antonsen in a way because he's clearly not fully recovered from COVID-19, but I also feel absolutely delighted for Vittinghus because it's been so long since he was last in a final.
Eight.
Last final he was in was the Denmark International Challenger of 2019 Challenger event.
Yep.
Not even a World Tour 100 event, let alone part of the HSBC BWF World Tour.
If my memory is not serving me, I think that he went to the final of the World Tour final, so it was called the Super Series finals at the time in Dubai. I think I remember was that
2014. 2014. And interestingly, Vittinghus said afterwards, he said, this doesn't count as a final. He said, because I lost a group match. And in a normal Super Series tournament, he would have been out.
Yeah.
But because we play the group stage, and that's the beauty of next week, isn't it? At the HSBC BWF World Tour Finals here in Bangkok.
Yeah. Sometimes it's creating drama.
Yes. Great defense, my goodness. Vittinghus is on fire.
Service over, 9-1.
I can't hear what they're saying, but they're talking to one another as they
look at this dive.
The kit box.
Look at that. Oh, what beautiful images. Full length dive. Look at the block, how close it was to the net. Well, if that doesn't make our play of the day, I'm going to eat my hat.
The one we haven't got.
Don't tell people that. Another good defense.
Yeah, Antonsen is trying now. He's trying.
That's gone long.
He's got nothing left.
No.
10-1.
Nothing left. He's looking to the coach, but there's no coach.
Well, when he played in the final of the World Championships, Anders Antonsen against Kento Momota in Basel in 2019, he was 6-2 up in the first game, and then he only won six more points in the entirety of the match. But that was different. That was an accumulation of tiredness throughout all his matches that week. This is different. I feel this, sadly, is the aftermath of this horrible virus.
Good play.
Yeah.
Good play.
Service over. 2.
But
ten.
I was interested in you talking the other day, Morten, when we were commentating on Anders Antonsen against Verma. In fact, it was yesterday.
Yesterday, yes.
And you were saying that physically there's a weakness there anyway with Antonsen.
Yeah, there is. And you pointed it out in Basel in 2019 at the World Champs, but we also saw it in Super 1000 in China, same year. One long rally at the end of the first game, I think it was, and after that, there was nothing left in the legs of Antonsen. Mm. So it's I think it's a combination of the two.
Yeah. Well, don't. I think this is a foregone conclusion because I've seen Vittinghus lose matches when being in a very commanding position.
Yes, me too. I have seen it on a number of occasions. And I think this is what Antonsen have to do. Cleverly played, have to play the net. Doesn't cost him much of energy.
But he has a 7-point advantage at the mid-game interval. Hans-Kristian Vittinghus, having won the opening game. And Antonsen really does look like a spent force. I'm actually very concerned for him. I have to be serious. I was in contact with Vittinghus during the lockdown period, the first lockdown period. We were talking dogs. He's got
seconds.
Two dogs. His wife is a dressage rider, international dressage rider. So obviously the family likes animals.
Yep.
Two dogs. He's got a fox red Labrador. We were talking Labradors because I've got two Labradors. Chocolate ones.
Chocolate
ones. But real ones, I don't mean.
I don't know what you mean, colour wise.
Colour wise, exactly. Yeah.
12-4.
There is nothing. I'm almost at the stage, Morten. I'm so concerned about Anna's. Antonsen, that if this was a boxing match, the towel would have been thrown in.
Yes, by the coach.
Yes.
Or the trainer. 13. Is it called the trainer in boxing?
In boxing, I think it's the trainer.
Yeah.
Or the corner, by somebody in the corner.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, 10-point advantage now. But all credit to Antonsen. He's not quitting. He's obviously physically in a bad place. But he's not giving up. Yeah, he is defending well, is Vittinghus, but he's known for that.
Out.
16-4.
Well, that opening game for Vittinghus proved very, very important because I think it's broken the spirit of his opponent, Antonsen. Broken physically, without any question, now broken mentally as well. Oh, yes, that's nice.
Service over. 5-16. Hello. 6-16.
Well, 16. I heard a little come on in Danish from Antonsen. There's no recovery from Antonsen. After he played that round the head shots, he stopped. There's nothing in the legs. Take a look at this. Round the head, stops. It's quite extraordinary. We'll see it better here.
It's coming back.
Yeah.
So he's got to play another shot, hoping it was the winner.
Was a good punch.
Service over. 8-17.
Yeah. Well, Service it's sad to watch, 18, to be honest, Morten, 8. Because I know that Antonsen. This is just a shadow of what he's capable of.
Oh!
2 points away
19
from his eight. First final at this level of event since 2016. And the Australian Open.
But I think Antonsen needs to learn from this. His body language is simply not good enough. I know that he's in discomfort and all that, but he must learn to hide it better. He must learn to work through the pain now and again. This display has, in my book, not been good enough.
No. Match point opportunities. And finally, we've had a verbal celebration from Hans-Kristian Vittinghus. And I'm willing to bet we'll have one in a minute when he wins his 21st point of this second game.
Yeah, I think you're right on that.
Game.
Yeah, he can hardly believe it. Well, I was wrong about the verbal celebration.
Me too.
Well,
match won by
Antonsen
has
a lot of thinking to do and a lot of recovering to do.
21-19, 21-8.
Yeah, he's got another tournament next week as he has qualified for the World Tour Finals.
Absolutely. So it was a very one-sided second game. Good opening game. But Hans-Kristian Vittinghus will contest his first final tomorrow at this level of event for 4.5 years. Their confirmation of the scoreline, 21-19, 21-8 in a match lasting 44 minutes. Well, coming up next, we've got women's singles and two players who have been on top of the world rankings. It's the current world number one, Tai Su Ying, against the former world champion, Ratchanuk Intanon.